this thing working?
Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for coming. As usual, I'll tell you the story of how we had Mr. Draper to come here.
Mr. Draper?
Yeah.
Remember this when you're addressing me at work.
I'd heard of him, but I didn't know a great deal about him. And we went up to Wales TUC conference back in May. And we went to they have fringe meetings, so we went to a fringe meeting and Ronnie spoke. And I came out to the fringe meeting, I didn't even get as far as the landing. And I said to Tommy, we're having him for the SO. And he said, oh, we can't have him for the SO, I want a woman. That makes it sound a bit good. I want a woman to come, we've never had a woman to come. And I said, I'm telling you now, we're going to have Ronnie Draper to come. Anyway, the next day there was another fringe meeting and he spoke again. And I went outside and I said, forget a woman, we are having Ronnie Draper. Oh, well, what do I do? And I said, I don't care what you're going to do, just ask him and see if he can. So anyway, the following day he said, I've spoken to Ronnie Draper and he's going to come. And I said, good lad. Well, I didn't know at that point what was going to happen to him in the summer to the Labour Party.
Yeah,
and I thought, oh, every year we do an S.O.Davies and every year there's controversy over it. And look at what's happening now. But it all turned out well in the end, and I'm sure he'll tell us about it. So, ladies and gentlemen, Ronnie Draper.
Thank you very much. It's good to know that I was second choice. Anyway,
I seem to think I might have been third choice. I think the cash was before me.
First of all, can I just say, Cllr have been just absolutely brilliant to be here. And Cllr people from the Baker's Food and Allied Workers Union, who cover the whole of the UK and Ireland. It's great to be amongst like-minded people because you'd be surprised how many times you get the option of speaking at meetings and there'll be hecklers and there'll be people who are totally disagreeing with what you're saying. It's an absolute pleasure to be asked to deliver the S.O.Davies Memorial Lecture, particularly knowing all the people who you've had speaking at it before. Bob Crow and John MacDonald, Jeremy Corbyn, Eric Heffer, who incidentally my mum used to go out with. So it's all downhill from there anyway. So Tom did say to me, he said, we've got this long tradition of having left-wing speakers at the meeting, and it was sort of the legacy of Stephen Owen Davis. And during the last few weeks I was looking at the list of influential speakers. My favourite Tory DJ, Ian Dale, you see him, he does it every year. He does this 100 influential left-wingers within the country. And I thought, I wonder if I'll get on that. I wonder how far I'll be. And so, you do that. You look, you go to number one and you come down the list. I was, see what number I'll appear. So I looked at it, started off number one, Jeremy Corbyn. I thought, that's great. Great. He's being recognised by even the Tory as being an influential left-winger. That's fantastic. And then I slide down and get to number four and John MacDonald's there. And I thought, great, John. Great meeting the trade unions, fantastic. Anyway, I carry on a bit further, I go down to the 20s, still no Ronnie's even there. I'm going down, I get to the 20s and I find Chukka and Moon, and I'm starting to get worried about it. Chukka and Moon and Dave Prentice next to each other. I really started to think, well, is it just a mistake by a DJ, or is he really thinking this way? I got down to the 40s and Ed Balls and Jess Phillips. I thought, must have been done before she made all those folk powers, or before Ed Balls started dancing. Maybe they've seen me dancing, maybe that's why I'm not in the top 40. Anyway, I carried on. I got to the 60s and I was starting to wonder whether Ian Dale was pissed when he wrote it. Particularly when I got to Tony Blair, Neil Kinnock, and Paul Sainsbury. Anyway, so according to Mr. Dale, I wasn't in the top 100. I'm somewhere between David Cameron and Genghis Khan. So the myth of left-wing speakers has been truly blown tonight, Tom, so we'll see where we go. I contrast it though, because not everybody thinks I'm not a left-winger. I was on holiday in Portugal last year, and I got a phone call. First morning on Sunday I was there. from the people from our union, you know, Brian Scar, who used to be one of our EC members, sent me a text, sorry, and he said, "Have you seen the sun this morning? You're in the sun." So I said, "Am I? What am I in the sun?" I phoned him. Just, what am I in the sun? He said, "They called you a trick cyclist." I said, "Trick cyclist? I've got a bike." "Never mind a trick cyclist." He's called you. I said, "Spell it." And he spelled it. "That's bloody Trotskyist, you." He called me a Trotskyist, but anyway. He called me a Trotskyist because I called, I think, maybe David Cannon, or one of them anyway. I said, "Sorry, totally scum." And when I arrive, when I come back, I don't do interviews with the Sun, I always refuse them. And that's why you never found anything about the Labour Party in the Sun, what they say they made up. But a guy called Chris Woodhead, who's a reporter for the Sun, phoned me up as soon as I got back and asked me for an interview. I said, "Look, I don't do interviews with the Sun." And I said, "I know what you wrote about me, I don't agree with you." He said, "But you called them Tory scum." He said, "Why would you possibly call them that?" I said, "Because I was at a meeting and it was before 9 o'clock and I didn't want to call them what I really wanted to call them, so I called them Tory scum." Seriously, comrades, I'm proud to lead one of the most progressive unions in the TUC, and those who know the record of what's gone on with our union over the past, I'm sure, will agree with that. We're small, but we're beautifully formed. We're not a union that's particularly looking for publicity on television. We want the publicity when we get out to meet with workers and achieving, campaigning on their behalf. 1847 we started. I got a taxi in Liverpool last night and the taxi driver said to me, "Baker's Union." He said, "Oh, you're a new one." I said, "No, no, it's 1847. He says, "Well, what have you done in the past?" I said, "Oh," I said, "you obviously don't read much about trade unions. We've had more battles than Montgomery had during the war." So that's how we've been. But a great campaigning union. If you go back and read our history from the days of Cllr bacon, when people used to work in cellars, producing bread and dying because of carbon monoxide poison, right through to working with working temperatures in the workplace. And we were the union who were asked on behalf of the TUC to lead the campaign with government and with the HSE on working temperatures. From Baker's asthma, which was never recognised, and yet Ramazzini back in the 17th century recognised that people's occupations altered their health significantly. He recognised that bakers of bread, millers of flour were under serious risks to their health. And it wasn't until 1976 that we got occupational asthma, baker's asthma, recognised as a prescribed industrial disease, and that was done by this union. And of course, one of our greatest campaigns that we're on at the moment is the £10 an hour campaign, which we believe is something that everybody should not have to aspire to, they should be on it now. Everybody should have a program. Think that, you know, we're following in the footsteps of some of the great trade union victories of the past, and we can all reel them off if we've read the materials that have been produced. But what we should be doing, and we train on our cause, that we should be recognising the sacrifices that our predecessors took. It isn't just the sacrifices we make now in the fight to gain victories, it's looking back and learning from the past victories in the long distant past. I want to just, for a brief moment, talk about how things significantly changed for our union. It kind of goes back as far as 2013, when we had a three-week dispute in Wigan, when 400 workers who were working at a very organised site, but not a particularly militant site, just a site that bobbed along day to day, did what they had to do, got their earnings and went home. And these 400 workers took a stance against the company who were trying to affect employment conditions, not for them, but for future generations. So like talking about bringing agency labour in, bringing short-term contracts in, making sure that overtime was controlled by the company. All those sort of things, and 400 workers, to the man and woman, to the union member, walked out on strike. And they were out there for a number of weeks, I say three. This factory was dependent on running on short-term contracts, and that had to stop. I read a little bit of a history about S.O.Davies and saw the campaigns that he was involved with in mining. Well, the city I'm from, Liverpool, was exactly the same on the docks, where people used to queue to see if they were good enough to get a job that day, the casualisation of labour, and people would be standing out, they'd be up there early morning, waiting to see if there was a job there. And if your face fitted, you may well get a job. But if your face didn't fit, then of course, there was no work for you. You went back to the poverty, because we all know that we go back, you know, before the war. We never had all the benefits that are there, you know, since the creation of the welfare state with labour. And so, this company wanted to introduce it, take that step further and bring agency labour on. And the workers said no. Some of these short-term contract people or casual people had worked for the company for years. And so the members of our union says no, we're going to take a stance, and they went on strike. And, you know, they were under immense threats. This is not like, you know yourselves if you've tried to take industrial action. It isn't like it used to be on the rag trade when it was whistleblowers, our brothers out, and you used to do it. Because believe me, I've done that when I worked in Scots in Liverpool. We would just walk out, but with the changes in legislation, people have to jump through hoops, and we know it's going to get even harder with the Trade Union Act. The fact is, these people balloted, they got a massive yes vote for strike action, they took that action, and despite the company saying that they were going to sack them, they were going to sequestrate the funds of the union. This is one of the big threats they made to me. I remember driving home from my office in Wigan City down to where I live in the New Forest and getting a call off Brian Carlton, who was the HR director for Premier Foods. Above, they owned Hovis, Premier Foods, to threaten me that they were going to take the union's money. And I said, well, if you believe we're doing something wrong, then you should do that. You should go to court, and what we'll do, we'll defend it as robustly as we can. He said, the other thing is, he said, because you're the leader of the union, we're going to come after you for your own finances. We're going to come after you. We're going after your house. And I said, pal, join the queue. I've just got divorced. My wife's after it as well. You've got to put somewhere way down the road. One of the things I would say about that dispute, though, is those 400 workers could never have won it on their own. Because the company would have just flooded it with managers, they'd have broke the strike, they'd have got agency drivers out to run people over. It couldn't have been achieved. But what that did, it was actually a magnet for trade unionists, particularly the left wing within the trade union, to come together. You know, if I said to you about all the unions who you would never guess would be on strike, or very rarely on strike, you'd say, the Liverpool won't go on strike. You know, community don't particularly go on strike. We had members from community, Usdaw, Unison, Teachers Unions, GMB, Unite, you reel the union off, and we had them on that picket line. There's legislation tells us that on strike we have to have a maximum of six members, six people on a picket line. We had 400 on a picket line, and we stopped that company producing. But not only that, society, the local community were out helping us, they were bringing cups of tea to pickets. They were helping us go out and boycott the products within supermarkets. We've got nationally a campaign that said to the company, if you don't reinstate these people, if you don't settle this dispute, we're going to stop buying the burger spread this week. And if you carry on till next week, we're going to boycott Premier Foods products, so Bisto and all those sort of things. And so this was a snowball that was building and building against the company. They weren't fighting 400 people. They were absolutely fighting the might of the trade union movement. And the great thing it did, it brought the trade union movement together, because they saw Hovis as a focal point. They saw 400 people who were prepared to have a go, who were prepared to fight for not only their future, but the future of generations to come. And they gathered round and they made sure that those people were never starved back. The press were on our side, the police were on our side. We never had one arrest on that picket line, despite they could have arrested 394 of those 400 there. They never arrested anyone. There was no sequestration, there was no court appearance. I still ended up with my house, well, for a short time, and we carried on. And those people went back to work at just one little brief story. I got a call, I was in Bournemouth, and I got a call at this Brian Carlton. This is the guy who was threatened to take my house. He probably said, oh, Ronnie, so I'm going to concede some of these things. He said, those casuals, he said, we know that there's jobs there for them. He said, what we've decided to do today is that we've told them, we've wrote to them all, and we've told them they've got a full-time job. That was great. It was one of the things that we came up for, achieved. Absolutely brilliant. 20 people got the job. So I phoned the official, the local official, said, those people have got a job, haven't they? He went, no, he said, I'm with them. He said, they haven't been told that. So I phoned Brian, come back. I said, Brian, these people haven't got a job. Those people haven't received a letter. And he went, I'll check. Come back to me 10 minutes later. He said, your fault. He said, your strike was that good. He said, the postman wouldn't come in and collect that. He said, the CWU members wouldn't come in and collect the mail and deliver. So it was effective. So what we did, we got the message out to these people. Well, from Monday, or once the strike's over, you've got a job. And he said, thank God for that. And he joined the people again and strike with us. Fantastic it was. So this, as I say, was a triumph for our movement. You know, we challenged the Tory anti-union trade union legislation on picket, and we won. And as I said before, all the time we had more than the pickets that we were allowed. And never did we get a complaint off the neighbours about noise, about, you know, the, you know, what's going on outside, with wagons revving up. We stopped it, and that was the great thing. They, as I say, they offered many compromises to the company. Until I was speaking in a meeting at the People's Assembly in Dublin, and I was just getting on the plane to come back, and Brian Carr, who recently told me that hell would freeze over before we got a victory. We got it, hell must have froze over, he capitulated, and the great news is that him and the other three directors who caused the strike were all dismissed by the company. I think the greatest victory that was not necessarily the winning of working practices in there and, you know, get the people back to work. It was, as I say, the confidence that spread throughout the movement. But what I particularly liked about it was that that branch, 400 people, as I said before, it wasn't a particularly militant branch, became politicised. They saw what people had done for them. They saw the support they got from the press, from, you know, the media, the support they got from the community, the, you know, what they got from people in Wigan, the financial backing that they got. They changed their own minds, and without going through expensive courses, they became politicised to the extent where, a few weeks later, the fire brigade union had a strike. And before the fire brigade started at 6 o'clock in the morning, before the fire brigade members got on the picket line, members from Wigan were on their picket line waiting for them and clapping them out and stood on that picket line and getting them the victory that they deserved. And of course, it's given us confidence in other parts of our own union. You know, we've recently had a dispute with a company called Two Sisters at Rogerston Park in Newport. And it gave the confidence of people to come out on strike there. At exactly the same time, the same company were attacking one of our other branches in Sheffield at Pennine Foods. And those workers looked back to see what had been achieved at Hovis and believed that they could achieve the same. And to a very great extent, they did. In particular, with the one in Sheffield, they'd come out on strike to stop the company cutting their terms and conditions, and ended up going back after 2 weeks strike, or two-day strikes, to not only the withdrawal of those threats, but also a pay rise as well. And that was fantastic. So again, that pebble in the pool effect has gone round and got those people to fight for their victory. So it was a support across the movement that I believe was a direct inspiration from the people in Wigan. So when we tell people, when the government say, when people within the trade union movement say to you, strikes don't work, don't do it, they'll never work, you can't win with a strike, you tell them that you can, you absolutely can win with a strike, as long as you are prepared to back it yourselves, as individuals, that your union is behind you, backing you, and those people would never say that our union wasn't behind them, and that we can get the consensus opinion around there that is a fight worth winning. So we protect our livelihoods and our services by attacking these companies. You go back, you know, the Tulpuddle Martyrs, the Chartists, the Diggers, the Suffragists. There's nothing that we've ever achieved in this life that hasn't been achieved without sacrifice. Whether that be a strike, or in the case of the Suffragettes, that people giving up their lives to win a vote. We've never won anything without a struggle. I've never known a company, we have 200 branches, I've never known one company who say, come in, we'll just wait to give you a pay rise, here, money, sit down, have a cup of tea. It is a struggle now as much as it ever was, but I'll tell you what, they were more prepared to fight for it in the past. What we've got to do is use that model to make sure that we do it. good mate of mine, Bob Crowe, one of the phrases that he always used to use was that if we fight, we may not win. But if we don't fight, we'll definitely lose. Yeah. And that's as poignant today as it was the day that he made it. And of course, when he said it, it was also reflecting history. It was something that had gone on from the past. I do remember, Bob, just that, you know, I think it'd be remiss not to tell a short story about him. We were at the TUC and he came to him and he said, Ronnie, will you do me a favour? He said, we've got a motion this afternoon. And he said, will you second it? So I said, yeah, okay, Bob, what is it? He said, it's on Viking and Laval. And I thought, don't know what Viking and Laval is, what is it? And it was something to do with European transport systems and whatever. So I said, you give me a few, you know, a few pointers. I'll give it a whirl, you know what I mean? I'll give it a go. So I did. He moved it, great speech. I seconded it. Everybody else lined up against us. The chair was against us. The general counsel were against us. It went to the, oh, Bob, right to reply, great response. Went to the vote. Two unions voted for it. RMT, Baker's Union, everybody else voted against it. And I was sat at the back of the hall and Bob Crowe walked right down the middle like that and he slapped me on the back. And he always called me son, even though I was older than him. So he said, if you'd been in the Olympics, he said, you'd have got a silver medal for that speech. So do you want to talk to me just for a few minutes about what's going on in America? Because I think it's chronic. It would be a joke if it wasn't so tragic. What's happening to people's lives in America and the effect, the knock-on effect that's going to go out right across the globe. You know, I watched the debate, the first debate, I watched part of the second debate as well, and think to myself, how could Americans possibly vote for somebody like Donald Trump? You know, he stands, you know, as a platform, it's a racist platform, it's a sexist platform, it's an anti-work problem, it's an anti-disabled person platform, all the things that he's doing. You know, somebody said to me when I spoke at the POA conference, he said, it could be worse, you know, we could have Trump. And I think, no, it couldn't. Think about what we've got. Think about the different policies that this Tory party has. Think about when Sadiq Khan was standing as London mayor and the racist garbage that was coming from Zach Goldsmith and his team to try and do down Sadiq Khan. Whether you like Sadiq Khan or you don't like him, whether you are a Labour, I'm sure you are a Labour supporter, but even if you're not, what the poison that was laid down against him was totally, overtly racist. And then they do the thing, Jeremy Hunt, the thing with the NHS, the junior doctors' contracts. It is overtly sexist in that it directly affects young female doctors worse than men. It draws a division. It's at a time when we should be uniting and equalising gender. The Tories are driving a wedge in when it comes to one of the, you know, the best professions that we have within our NHS, they're trying to drive it. And of course, you don't need reminding about what they're doing with workers. They've absolutely hammered us over the years, haven't they? You know, all the stuff they've done. Now they've brought in this Trade Union Act. And I've got to say, I'm disappointed with what the TUC did on the Union Bill. Absolutely. If you were involved in the meetings in London, it wasn't the TUC who were doing it, or the General Council. It was actually the TUCG, of which our unions are members, the Trade Union Coordinating Group, so Matt Rack and people like that, standing outside Parliament, campaigning against the Trade Union Act. And all the stuff that they put in, absolutely, you know, some of it was never wanted, they never wanted. It was used as a red herring to give you a victory. I remember Joe Stevens, who's a Welsh MP, I like Joe very much, but speaking at the Prison Officers Association, she said, you know, we've got some victories out of this. Let me tell you, we've got no victories. We got some concessions. We got some concessions that we were always going to get. You know, if you thought for 1 minute you were really serious about making, you know, somebody wear an armband to say, I'm a picket marshal. I'll tell you, the idea that we had, our executive took a decision that if we had a strike, every single person who was on our picket line would have an armband that said, I'm a picket marshal. It'll be I'm Spartacus. Everybody would have gone. And this thing about when the certification officer can just march into your office and look at your books to see what you spent on political activity. Well, I don't know if he's going to do it in our office because he hasn't got a key. I know he hasn't got a key. I know he's got a key for our office. The certification officer hasn't got one. And if he doesn't make an appointment, he ain't coming into our office.
Yeah.
The thing that they want is they want thresholds. And that's where we've got a big education that we've got to move amongst our members. Not people sitting on their hands, because going back to the words of Bob Crowe, if we don't fight, we'll never win. And people will think, well, we'll just sit back this time, let the company have that little bit, but next time we'll do it, and then they don't do it the next time. Eventually you end up, you're on the basic, you're on the absolute basic and nothing more. And that's where the government want people, and that's where the legislation is. You know, if you look at the what's going on now with this, you know, the Tories say that they're the party of working class. I remember them saying it a couple of times, I thought, no, he's drunk, been on drugs or something. It can't be true. What sort of party introduces the Trade Union Act, for the first of all, to hamstring workers from taking action? But more importantly, what sort of a workers' party brings in a minimum wage of £7.20 without bringing in parallel legislation that stops these unscrupulous employers from attacking and having a feast on what's happening with terms and conditions? So we're doing it, we're going through all the battles. You've seen it probably yourself. Tesco's, B&Q, so it's not a small company, it's Tesco's, B&Q, Two Sisters, which is a massive company, one of the fastest growing within the food industry, who we were in with them. Samworth Brothers, who you might not know, but they have Ginsters, they own them, Story, Motlow, all them. We have members in there. These people are now paying £7.20, and as a quid pro quo, they're taking Sunday payments, bank holiday payments, overtime premiums, cutting breaks. Was that meeting yesterday when one of the branches in Manchester said the company want to reduce our working week from 39 down to 35.5, and what they're going to do, instead of having paid meal breaks, we're going to have unpaid meal breaks. But they're going to give us that money on our basic rate. I said, don't be stupid. Don't sacrifice it, because what's going to happen? They'll give you the rate this year, then next year, you've lost your breaks, and they'll give you a pay freeze. And a pay freeze the year after, and eventually you'll be on minimum wage, but you will have lost your breaks. And so we have to fight on those sort of things. This is a living wage. If you call that a living, it's a joke, isn't it? It started off £2 less than the Living Wage Foundation to start off with. They call it a living wage that's meant to lift people out of poverty. It's meant to stop people drawing in work benefits. And what's it doing? It's creating poverty. When people don't earn the overtime, like use an example of one of our women members in Cattleby Foods, which is part of Samworth Brothers, she only works a Sunday. She gets double time. That's the negotiated rate. The company are now saying they're going to pay single time for Sunday. But no one's going to be affected. Well, that woman's going to be directly affected. You know, she's got a family to bring up, and she's going to be, everyone's going to be halved over the next 2 years. No compensation for her other than you're going to go up from £6.70 an hour to £7.20. Whoopee-doo. And that's exactly what's happening. We've got more and more of our members as well in these companies where we're trying to get in who are more reliant on food banks. That's a reality of what's happening in this country. And I'll tell you what, you may be on more than £10, I don't know. But I'll tell you what, you'll know somebody. It'll be somebody in your family who's on poverty wages, somebody who's on 0 hour contract who's being abused on a weekly basis. It's happening all round. When I moved the motion at the 2014 TUC to introduce a £10 an hour minimum wage, not a living wage, a £10 an hour minimum wage for everybody, that in itself, and we did the research, would have lifted in one fell swoop 5 million people out of poverty. It would have reduced the dependence on workplace benefits, which many, many families, working families, are doing today. And above all, it would have brought dignity to millions of workers who face the indignity every week of taking home a small pay packet and living hand to mouth to survive. Unfortunately, I've got to say, the silence from the TUC has been absolutely deafening. This motion was 100% unanimously carried. Of course, before I spoke, Francis O'Grady told me what I was going to say, gave the point of view of the General Counsel, and I told them what I was going to say and what we wanted. Because it isn't my view, it's the view of the people that we canvass. I'll tell you one thing, and Gary and the people from our union will tell them, everything we do as a policy, we do because our members tell us. Branches tell their conference delegates, every branch has the right to be a conference, And those Commons delegates, they set the policy. It isn't set by me as a General Secretary, or National President, or the Executive Council. It is set by the people who pay my wages and pay their wages. And that's how we see it. Unfortunately, as I say, the TUC have done nothing. And so it's been left to unions to win these campaigns. Unions like Unite, who've won a really good campaign with Sports Direct. They've shamed the man into paying proper wages. You know, whether the proper conditions... Unions like the GMB, who are running a really successful campaign on the high street. You know, using bootmakers and places like that. And of course, my own union, who are running a successful campaign within McDonald's and KFC and Wetherspoons and Subway and anybody else who Wetherspoons, we're having a go at it. We've won some really good victories. You know, I just used one where a bunch of young workers in Peterborough, in a Wetherspoons pub that we organised, refused to serve the BNP, sorry, not called BNP, what are they called? ETL now. The English Defence League, where they were having a march through the town. They, all members, a group of young people, all under 20, shut the pub and made sure that the EDL didn't get a pint of beer in the pub where our members were serving. As I say, you all know people who are on low wage. It might not be somebody in your family. It might not be necessarily a friend or a colleague. But think about the Saturday morning when you go down and put your bet on the football at Ladbrokes. Or you go to the shoe shop and buy a new pair of shoes. The girl who sat on the till in Tesco's or Asda. All these people are on poverty wages. They're on less than £10 an hour. And we believe that when money is being made like Tesco's and Asda and Marks and Spencer's and all the rest of them, McDonald's, the amount of naughts, I wouldn't even know how you pronounce the amount of money that they make. They don't count their profits in millions. McDonald's count their profits in billions. And none of it they pay tax in this country. None of it. You pay poverty wages. 94% of the people that they employ are on 0-hour contracts. And they don't pay nothing here. In fact, I went over to Brussels in January and filed a complaint against the non-payment of tax in this country. And also the use of exclusivity terms when it comes to 0-hour contracts. Because what they do, they don't say to a young person, oh, you haven't got any hours at all this week. They'll say, well, you've got 2 hours tomorrow and then you've got 6 on Thursday. But they won't tell you you've got 6 on Thursday until today, the day before. So you can't then say, I'm going to make an alternative arrangement and go find another job. And so it works out that it is an exclusivity, which is illegal. And so we filed that complaint in the European Court in Brussels to make it happen. People say it's unachievable, but let me tell you, it is not unachievable. Absolutely not unachievable. Look at the great victories that's happened in America with the $15 an hour campaign. It isn't just individual workplaces that doing it. New York, Dallas, Chicago, we've got regions now where the mayor is enforcing a minimum wage of $15 to people who are on $7 and $8 an hour. And not young, necessarily young people. These could be people in their 40s and their 50s who are bringing up families. Now, because they fought, they took a stand, they went on strike, they joined a union, the SEIU, and now they're enjoying those benefits, and it can work. And even in this country, I'm the senior negotiator for a company you all know, Greggs. Last year in the wage rise, we got Greggs to commit to at least 2 of the grades that they have being over £10 an hour. And that's not included overtime, that is a basic rate. Retail managers, now over £10 an hour, plus they get commission, they get overtime where overtime's payable. That was done because we used it as a campaign, as a building block. But probably the greatest victory we've got, and this is where I'm going to talk about this as well. One of the things that we did in Greggs is we got the abolition of youth rates. So a young person who's working next to a 25-year-old person, they don't understand this. If you're 25, you get this rate, and if you're 24, you get that rate. Yeah, yeah. Is a tin of beans the same price, or rent or flat the same price? When you get on the bus, it's not like you're at school, you're at school and you used to get your fare cheaper. It's exactly the same price. So these people are being directly discriminated by age. And so with Greg, we got rid of that. We're saying that that to us is what the old TUC slogan was, equal pay for work of equal value. Yeah. Well, those people, if they do the same job, are definitely equal value and therefore deserve that equal pay. The government's drive though now, and we're doing, I've just gone through the thing with the Union Learning Fund, the drive towards more and more apprenticeships. And those apprenticeships don't pay £7.20, they pay £3.30 an hour. And what's going to happen, you're going to see more and more young people, and may I say, older people, because it isn't exclusively to young people now, apprenticeships. You could be somebody who's 30 and they can give you an apprenticeship, and it would entitle them to pay £3.30. Now, of course, the likes of Greg have said, we'll pay the going rate to any apprentices that we take on, so they will actually get the rate for the job. But this, you're going to see a plethora of these things going on. I wouldn't be surprised if McDonald's all of a sudden say, they'll be celebrating the biggest apprenticeship scheme ever. You know, flipping burgers, of course you need an apprenticeship for that, or snacking shelves in Tesco's, that's an apprenticeship all right, because they'll be able to drive down wages. The problem you've got is it's building up to an economic time bomb in the future. Because not only can't these people, young people, afford houses, I mean, nobody can afford a house now, but in particular young people on low wages, they can't afford cars, they won't be able to afford holidays, but look into the future, they won't be able to afford pensions. And that's something that we've been dependent for our old age. I mean, everybody's struggling now. Pension funds are struggling, but they're going to struggle even more when young people can't put any money into them and companies are unwilling to do that. We're sleepwalking through a government-made economic disaster. And it isn't just the fact that they can't afford these things and that's going to affect the industry. Think about what's going to happen to those young people when they have the direct choice. I keep getting told by all these economists that to keep the economy buoyant, to keep it going, we have to have 2.2 children in every family. I don't know how you have 0.2, but get it by the way, I mean that's... But 2.2 is the figure that these economists come up that every family should have. How is somebody who's earning £3.30, or even, you know, just on the lower wages now for young people, how are they going to afford to have a family? How are they going to afford to keep children when they're struggling to keep themselves? They're going to be faced with the stark reality, stark choices. You know, these are saying for older people, eat or eat. This is going to be, you know, the question of whether they can afford to live and to have a family. And I think it's something that the government aren't taking any notice of. And I'm glad to see that the likes of Jeremy and John are saying that they will address this. They will address this. We get this spoon-fed this stuff all the time, and we have done prior to Brexit, that, you know, immigrants are coming over here and they're taking our jobs and they're driving down the rate for a job. Let me tell you, no immigrant ever took any job or drove down any rate of pay. It's the employer who drives down the rate of pay. Exploiting economic migrants. These people, let's be honest, every single person in this room wants to do better for themselves and for their family. And you can't then blame somebody who lives in Poland for wanting to do the same thing. And very often they're leaving their families behind and coming, you know, hundreds and hundreds of miles to get a job so they can benefit their families back home. So I don't blame anybody for wanting to better themselves, and even if they're better themselves over here. Nigel Farage and all the crap that he gave about, well, you know, every time I go around hospitals I see black faces. Of course, they were the nurses, they were the doctors, and I want to know whether that man, if he was ever injured in the future or taken seriously ill, would refuse the help of these African and Indian nurses and the Vietnamese and Chinese. I'll tell you what, he will not do it. And that's where we are with these people. And the other thing is that you see, when Osborne was in, I'm sure it won't change under the clan we've got now. When Osborne was in, it was all scaremongering. You know, this was the driver, this was the thing that we had to have to get austerity in, the con job to make sure that austerity was pushed forward. You remember all the things, it was, you know, while you're working, when you're coming off nights, you know, scroungers will be peeping through their curtains to see what you're doing, and then they're enjoying their benefits, they're living a high life. Well, nobody's ever lived a high life on benefits. It's not that great. Believe me, it isn't that great. I did it when I got blacklisted back in the 80s. It's a very, very poor existence, trying to get a job and having no money to live on. So it's nothing got to do with scroungers. Probably these people are on zero-hour contracts and they're waiting to see if they get a phone call to see if they've got a job today. If they're that great, low wages, if benefits are so great, then why don't we set it as a rate of pay for MPs? I have this thing, I've got many mates who are MPs. You know, really good friends, people who go around the fight with, who are MPs. I say to them, I don't see why we, as taxpayers, should be paying your second mortgage. I believe we have to pay something. I mean, you know, the MP for John O'Groats shouldn't be expected to travel on a daily basis down to London and back. It doesn't happen. You have to give them somewhere to live or a hotel or something. But why don't we, an example, the Olympic Village, all those houses that were built, why don't we do them up and do them up nicely? Because somebody's got to live there. Do them up and give them to an MP. And that's your house. If you've got a two-bedroom one, you get a two-bedroom one. You've got a three-bedroom, you've got a three-bedroom there. You may even build some. And you've got them for the duration of why you're an MP. You decorate it how you want. We might even give you an allowance for decorating it. Won't be the money you get now for decorating and doing the, you know, the moat around your castle. But we'll do something. And then when you lose your seat, or when you resign, or when people deselect you, which I'm sure is going to happen to a few people, then the house comes back to the taxpayer. It's our house, and we give it to the next person. You know, the thing though with Osborne, all the talk about people on benefits. The one thing that really pissed me off about him was when he said, "We cannot." Labour, who left us in debt, it was all Labour's fault, we know, and not to the banks and the merchants and all that, no, it was Labour's fault. Labour want to borrow money and they'll put you into debt that you'll never get out of. I'm seeing, as a Chancellor of the Exchequer, why we should ever leave future generations in debt. It's rubbish. We built a welfare state on debt between 1945 and 1949. Look what we built under a Labour government. And we went successful at the time. It wasn't when we had a great economy. We'd just come through two world wars. We were massively in debt, and yet we still created good housing, jobs for everyone, decent education, and above all, we created a national health service. And when did we pay off that debt? Because of course, you don't get these things for nothing. When did we pay it off? I'll tell you when we paid it off. 2005. 60 years later, we paid off that debt. And did you ever, I'm looking more at the older people who are in the room, did you ever hear people in your community, because I didn't in Liverpool, when I lived in, well, it ended up a slum area. I never heard anyone blaming past generations for leaving them in debt. You got on with it, you still lived in poverty, but people managed, and what we did, we got the legacy, we got a fantastic health service, a fantastic education system. That was all paid off. Comrades, you know, these values are the same visions that a modern Labour Party is looking at. Anyone, I say, you know, I've done quite a lot of work with Jeremy and John over the last few months, even though I had a little gap in it. These are the things that they're doing. These are the policies that they've got. And when they announce it, it isn't bullshit. It isn't a manifesto promise that's going to be broken when they get in. These are the things that Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell and a lot of other MPs have been saying for decades. So, I don't know who's Owen Smith supporting him. When Owen Smith was coming out and saying, that's my policy, that's the policy I'm standing on, he was talking about stuff that Jeremy had been saying for 20 years. They weren't new policies, they were the policies that were already in place. Those two, I'll tell you, I stood shoulder to shoulder with my members on picket lines. They stood shoulder to shoulder outside McDonald's in Whitehall protesting against McDonald's. They've been on the picket lines with the junior doctors because that's the people that they are. They are working class MPs, and that's what we want. We want more working class MPs. They've grown a party. And bear in mind, it was a party that was growing out of the trade union movement. They've grown a party to more than 500,000. It is the biggest political movement in Europe. That does not happen by accident. It hasn't happened because Jeremy's a pin-up boy. He definitely isn't. It's happened because of what we are about, what we're trying to push through. And the response has been, and you've seen it yourself, is to purge thousands of members. It's been a coup. It's been absolutely disgraceful. On that Sunday when they said, oh no, it's just a coincidence, when on the hour, every hour, a shadow cabinet minister resigned. It was an absolute disgrace that was happening. Yeah. Yeah. Some of those people... To me, some of those people will never go back anywhere near a shadow cabinet because I think it was an absolute disgrace. And it isn't something that was just planned on that Sunday. This has been something that has been planned prior to Jeremy being elected the first time, once they realised he was going to be there. You know, they blamed Corbyn for Brexit, and yet he was out, I think he was the second most MP who was out round campaigning. He delivered in his own thing, as did John McDonnell, a Remain vote. And all those who are condemning him had Brexit votes when they were campaigning for Remain. So it's anyone who didn't do the job right. It was those hundreds of MPs who were out there not selling the story properly. And then you look at some of the critics he's got. Blair, Matt Wilson, Alistair Campbell, Kinnock. They've all been wheeled out to tell us that Corbyn is unelectable. Despite the victories that we've had in by-elections, despite the fact that we've won mayoral elections, despite the fact that our party has more than doubled in members and is now a moving forward grassroots party. Why are they saying that? They're not worried that Jeremy Corbyn is unelectable. Let me tell you, those people are worried that he will be elected. Yes, yes. Yeah. And they will have to put into train some of these working class policies. Policies for people, the real working class people, the people the Labour Party was born to do. They're worried that they may have to do that. And I think it's pretty rich from somebody like Kinnock anyway to be preaching whether Jeremy is electable or not. I went to his second victory parade in Blackburn Town Hall the night before he lost the second one. I mean, he's got a 100% record on elections. He loses them all, he's no good, he never was. All he did was... All he got the credit for was written the Labour Party of militants. And I suppose, what is militants? I mean, for me, it isn't necessarily a political movement. Militants, trade unions, do got off their arse and started doing something. It's about a movement of getting people to go forward. And that's what he did. They're afraid, as I say, that they'll have to face the challenges of the future. They're going to bring the things that are for us to fight for. And they're going to be difficult, you know. It isn't just an easy ride, just say, cha-ching, we'll do that tomorrow. And there's going to be a lot of hard work that is going to have to be involved in these. It's going to mean an awful lot of commitment from the people of this country. There's going to be spurious objections to Corbyn because of his views on Trident. I mean, somebody asked me, and I said, well, look, we've got one, we've never used it. I mean, what are we getting a new one for? You know, I just don't see what all the furore is, because you have to be mad to press the button in the first place. And if Putin presses the button, oh, God, Trump, it might happen. Trump presses the button, by the time he's pressed, it'll be too late, because we'll all be kissing our asses goodbye, and they'll all be in bunkers under Downing Street or something, so it won't matter. I've got to say, I just want to come to the end, but I think it'd be remiss not maybe to talk about a little about what's happened to the Labour Party. Because one thing I have got in common with Cllr, who was S.O.Davies' wife, is that we were both suspended from the Labour Party. Mm-hmm. Different reasons, of course, but I was suspended. And the important thing is, I was suspended without reason. At first, I was on a 2 days holiday with my family, having a nice day. I got an email, which I would not necessarily read, because I thought, you get lots of spam emails of the Labour Party. And I got one, it was a supporter application. That's what it said. I'm not going to spin it, I'm not going to take any notes of it. And I don't know why, probably I was waiting for my daughter-in-law and the son to get ready. So I read it, and told me, right, suspended. No right of appeal, and So I contacted a few people who I knew that they were like, what is that? What it is, they trolled. They had this programme, and I don't know enough about, but they trolled everybody. I don't mean this big-headedly. I don't think they knew they got me. They had got me, but they didn't know who it was at the time. It was just a name they put, yeah, suspend, do whatever. You know, they had this set of words that you're going to be suspended. When I got handed, my life was made an absolute misery for 2 days. When I should have been enjoying my kids and my grandkids, I was plagued. Let me tell you, my Twitter feed took 8,000 hits on the first day. You know, messages from every single, you name the press, paper, radio station, television station, even German television, Russia Today, all that wanted to interview. The village I live in, I've only just got electricity. So imagine a shop, a television crew turn up. It would have been absolutely horrendous one. So, but this is where we were. I engaged a lawyer, which I suppose I'm fortunate, and let me say, my union never paid for my lawyer. I engaged the lawyer myself, suspended as an individual member, not as a general secretary. And I engaged a guy called Martin Howe, who was a lawyer who got Jeremy on the ballot paper when the Labour Party were trying to, when some people within the Labour Party were trying to get him off. I engaged him. Though he was good enough to do that, he was good enough to get me back in. And so I engaged him, and I've got to say, he was absolutely fantastic. On the following Tuesday, the day after the bank holiday, Nancy Platts, who's Jeremy Corbyn's trade union liaison officer, said there's a number on the letter he had been sent, which by then I have got a letter, an 0345 number. She said, ring him, and they'll give you the reason why you've been suspended. So it's comical. I phoned him, and you get through to Newcastle. And this young lad picked the phone up, nice lad. You know, obviously, good telephone manner and all that. I said, I phoned up, I said, well, I've been suspended from the Labour Party. I phoned him for the reason why I've been suspended. He said, can you give me a membership number? So I gave him my membership number. And as soon as he got me a membership number and typed it, he went, hang on, I've got a passion over here, just in case I say the wrong thing. So clearly, they've got a flag on my name, because these legal letters are going backward and forward between the General Secretary of the Labour Party and my lawyer. And I've got to say, he was absolutely superb. He said, I've got to pass you over to the supervisor. So I said, okay, go on then. No, nobody's going, he's a young lad. He's passing me over to a young woman. Again, very, very nice woman. Woman called Jane. You know, great manner and all that. And I says, Jane, I rang up for the reason why I've been suspended. And she said, I can't tell you. I said, well, you've sent me a letter saying that I phoned up this number and you'll give me the reason why I've been suspended. And she said, no, I can't tell you. I said, well, hang on, you've released stuff to the press, which they had on day one. They released it, not me, but I didn't know. They released the reasons to the press and they wouldn't tell me what the reasons were. And so I want to know. So she said, look, I know who you are. And I went, yeah, I'm Ronnie Draper, I'm a member of New Forest West CLP. She went, no, I know who you really are. I really am Ronnie Draper from New Forest West CLP. She went, yes, but you're the General Secretary. I said, well, that letter doesn't say you suspended me for being the General Secretary. He says I'm suspended as a member, an individual member I'm suspended for. So she said, well, I can't tell you, and I'll tell you in 4, I'll write to you within 4 days. I said, okay, now bear in mind that is on the Tuesday. So 4 days for me. Friday, nothing. The following Wednesday, I'm going to speak at a Stop the Purge meeting. But funny, I got invited to lots and lots of meetings to go and speak. Speak at the Stop the Purge meeting in London with Pamela Fitzpatrick, who I don't know whether any of you know. She's a Labour councillor who was also suspended at the same time as me. And so we were there, like the two profile speakers. And I didn't know Pamela, but we spoke at this meeting. Ironically, we were the two people out of everyone who got back in. So don't know how she got back in, but anyway, while I'm waiting on the railway station, I took another one of our officials with me to tape it, so that the press didn't say the wrong thing. I went to the Stop the Purge meeting, and on the way I got an email to tell me the reason why I'd been suspended. I'd been suspended not for anything I'd said. I got suspended for a retweet, and it was a guy who I don't know. I've got lots and lots of followers on Twitter. A guy had sent something out and he said the words that I've got the top of my head was something like, Jeremy Corbyn is a hostage or will be a hostage to the Blairite scum who will stop him introducing progressive policies. I like that retweet. It's not an endorsement. It's a continuation of a conversation, as I see it. I don't have to like what everyone says. I can agree with part of what he said. I don't analyse the words and I retweet it. And that's the thing that they said I've been suspended for. Then I get a phone call from my lawyer to say, Friday, Westminster, you've got a hearing. All right, you've got an appointment in court. No, you're going to go and see the regional director, regional organiser of the Labour Party. They're going to meet you and we're going to go through this thing. So I said, okay, that's fine, I'll be there. 10 o'clock, Southeast Regional Office of the Labour Party, which is in Westminster, I turn up with my lawyer. I was expecting to see it mobbed, I don't mean with reporters, I mean people who, because there's thousands, absolutely thousands of people who've been purged from the Labour Party for nothing. And there was no one. The only person in the queue was me. And anyone in our union, or those who followed the thing, will know on day one, I wrote a statement that went through our union, through our website, it went out, right through Twitter, went through Facebook, to say that I didn't want any privilege because of the position I'm in. Because I believe that I'm an individual member of the Labour Party, just like the other 10 or 12 or 20 or 100,000 people who've been purged, and I should not be treated any differently than them. That was a statement and a message that went out. But I was treated differently, because I got a hearing. There was nobody went in before me. I thought, well, maybe it's the first one, 10 o'clock in the morning, maybe the Labour Party don't start working like everybody else. Maybe the queue will be there when I come out. Nobody. There was absolutely nobody there. And when we went into the hearing, and this is maybe a bit comical, we went in, first of all, my lawyer laid into them. And the two young people who were the director and the organiser said, look, this is not a legal hearing. We just want to try and get this sorted out. I thought, well, there's no right to appeal. There's no right to a hearing, but I've got it. So he said to me, he had a piece of paper and he went, and shoved it across the paper, turned over, and he went, did you send that? And I went, it's got my name on it. He said, yeah, I did. See, I'm going to be Sherlock Holmes, so that's me. I said, well, look who wrote it. It's a retweet, it isn't. It isn't a tweet. And I explained the continuation of the conversation. So he says, well, it says in there the word scum. He said, why would you use the word, I said, well, look, it isn't particularly in my vocabulary. It's somebody else's words. I just retweeted it. So he says, oh, so next thing, he gets another piece of paper and he goes with that. And this is the thing that I thought I'd originally been suspended for. And it was for calling Labour MPs, those who'd resigned on the hour every hour, those who start the coup, those who put in the vote with no confidence, I call them traitors. I believe still to this day that they were traitors. And he slid this piece of paper over and turned around to me with these two tweets on that mentioned the word traitors. And he went, did you write that? And I went, they've got my name on as well. Yeah, I wrote them. And I said, well, I've not been suspended for that, so I don't need to answer questions on them. I was suspended for a retweet. He said, well, I want to broaden the conversation. So I said, well, you broaden the conversation, let's listen to what you have to say. He said, what do you think of that word that begins with T in both of them? He wouldn't even say the word, it just seems stupid. What do you think of the word in there that begins with T? And I look at it, and just coincidentally, but this is where it got comical, the last word in both of them was Tories. And I went, Tories, hate them, can't stand them, after, do you know what I mean? Really? And he went, no, not that word, the other one that begins with T. So I said, do you mean the word traitors? And he said, yeah. He said, why did you use the word traitors in a tweet? I said, because if it had put these despicable, disloyal members of Parliament, it wouldn't have fitted in 140 characters. Okay, he says, I'm going to write a report. I'll write a report. He said, it's going to go off. By this time, my lawyer's rolling about laughing about the Tory thing. And he said, I've got to write a report to the NEC. He says, and you'll have a decision whether you're back in the Labour Party today, this afternoon. And I said, well, Harry, there's no NEC today. He says, no, he says, I only have to get two NEC members. NEC's huge. I know that only two suspended me. And he says, I only have to get two NEC members to get you back in. I said, right, so I'll get you two. I said, Paulie McCarthy, out of my union, is on the NEC, I'll get her, I'll get Jenny for me from Unite, that's two. Absolutely, you know, that'll be. He says, no, you have to be the shoes I pick. So yeah, go on, get on with it. And I went away, and by 3:30 that afternoon, I was back in the Labour Party. And that is absolutely, it's great for me. It is absolutely diabolical that they can work that fast for a general secretary of a trade union, and yet for those other thousands of people who deserve the vote, who paid their money, who never got the vote. Comrades, as I come to the end, we should never again allow 172 members of parliament to hold 500,000 plus members. Workers' Party. This is born out of the trade union movement, and I say what we should be doing is paying tribute to those people who stood by Jeremy, those people who took on two or three jobs on the shadow cabinet, people like Davy Anderson, who struggles with English. He's a Geordie and he's in charge of Ireland. He was in charge of Ireland and Scotland, so that must have been a really great option. Those people are heroes and heroines in my mind, because they stood by him, they stood by the class that they're there to represent, and I pay tribute to those people. Coming in, I just want to finish off by saying, going back to the trade union theme, in 2013 I attended the TUC in Brighton, and it was a beautiful summer's day. I arrived on the Sunday and one of my reps said to me, "You having a pint?" Well, I went and put my suit on, got out my jeans on, and I put my suit on, ready to go to the conference. And I got my suit on and come down, there's a pint waiting for me. Beautiful summer's day, sat outside. And another general secretary come along to me and put his arm around me. Diametrically opposed to me, politically, but put his arm around me. And he said, "What do you think about Trotsky?" I said, "Not really, read a lot about it." He said, "No," he said, "Steve Gill, general secretary of the Prison Officers Association." I said, "What about him?" He said, "That motion he's putting in today," he said, "is looking at the feasibility of the TUC looking at the feasibility of a general strike." I said, "I think I'm seconding it." And he was absolutely mortified. And we went, this guy, he absolutely castigated Steve Gillen for asking a question. That's all it was. We went to the TUC, it got carried, there was a lot of toing and froing, but I think it just shows you what's going on within the TUC.
Yeah, yeah.
The General Council didn't vote for it. But we got one General Secretary of a big union, not going to say who it is, who got up, you can find out yourself, you get a verbatim report. One General Secretary got up and said, "We shouldn't be talking about a general strike. We tried it once and it never worked." I thought, bloody hell, it was in 1926. My mother wasn't born then. 1926. Comrades, we're never going to win nothing unless we fight for it. We're most certainly never going to know the answer as to whether people would take part in mass action, whether that be a general strike or whether it's coordinated action, because we've all got things in our workplaces that we're angry about, whether it's cutting pensions, cutting rates of pay, whether we're getting our holidays taken away from us, whether we're getting bullied or harassed, whether it's health and safety. Every single one of us, no matter how good that workplace, has got something that is wrong within it, and something that we want to take action. And it's not legal to take coordinated action. If we never ask the question of our members, we'll never know the answer. We did run a consultative ballot through our membership. I'm pretty sure we're the only union who did. And okay, a relatively small return. We got a 72% yes vote. People wouldn't talk part in it if the general council of the TUC called it. Of course we won't. And I questioned Frances O'Grady at the General Federation of Trade Unions conference when she thought she'd got away with it, but she kept looking. And I said to her, "Frances, what are we going to do? Bear in mind we've got this motion, I'm looking at the feasibility of the general strike. What are we going to do that's going to stop these attacks on working people? It's no good the marches through London. We do them and we all take part in it. It's a good day out and we wave our banners, you know, we make a lot of noise, we shout Maggie, oh, she's dead, isn't she? We shout whoever out. We do all the slogans that we've rehearsed over the years. We've all got bitter memories of what's gone in the past. And then we go to a rally on Hyde Park and we listen to loads of good speakers saying the right things and we clap. And then we go home. We block the traffic in London for a day. We go home, we go back to our workplaces, and many go back to poverty. Nothing in this world changes unless you do something. It's like, and I said to Francis, it's like Kim Jong-un's birthday in North Korea. I said, the roads are blocked, all the military, the tanks are down, and all those funny cuts, and the people with the marches, the tanks, the missiles, all down the road, blocking it, they're all waving at, you know, flags, all happy, smiling people. And the day after, every single one of those people go back to drudgery, they go back to poverty. Comrades, unless we, somebody, somewhere, eventually ask the question, and we grasp the nettle about doing something to get rid of this heinous government, to change capitalism for good, to change it to the common good of working people, we're never going to get anything. Thank you for listening to me.
I'm glad actually he mentioned the two sisters strike, because I got a story about that. I rang Tommy up and I said, what are you doing on Thursday? He said, why, what have you got in mind? I said, they're on strike and they bought. Oh, he said, brilliant, because we are in brilliant, he said, we go down. So he said, I'll take the car. Oh God, no, Tommy, don't you take the car. He's the worst driver in the world. So I looked up at the directions and off we went. And we got there, and there wasn't a picket line, and I knew they were out for 2 days. So we got to the front of the bakery, and there was nothing going on. So halfway down the road, still nothing going on. Down at the back end, still nothing going on. He said, oh, I'll go and ask in the burger van there. So he gets out to the car, I'm sat there, and here comes the police. Oh God, no, don't say you're a picketer. Please don't say you're a picketer, Tom. I know what you like. So the police go to the burger van, he comes back. He said, there's no strike yet. The man said, there's no strike yet. Copper knocks the window of the car. So I wind down the window and I said, yes. He said, you're looking for two sisters? And I said, yeah, we are. But there's nothing going on here. And he said, there's another one in Newport and you've come to the wrong one. Follow me. All right, officer, I said. So I went to the window back up and I said, he says, come follow him. This copper was brilliant. Every time he went on a roundabout, he slowed down for us to catch up with him. He led us right the way to it. We got out and we got the banner. And suddenly stopped and he thought, oh shit, what have I done? So off we went and put the banner up and we stood there with John. And it was a particularly nasty picket line, wasn't it? They were out there, the management were out there. There was about 10 or 12 of them and they stood there the whole day, didn't they? I've never seen anything like it. I cannot believe that a firm was paying a set of managers to stand outside. If they've got no work to do, sack the buggers. Don't leave them stand outside. So we stood there and the first lorry came up. So I said to Tommy, you stay with the banner, I'll go down and stop the lorry. I don't want you getting involved with the army. Too old for this now. No, I'm not, he says. I said, you stay with the banner, I'm going down. So I went down and the cop has got his head in his hands and he's thinking, I can arrest anyone here, but the one I can't arrest is her, because she'd stand in court and she'd say, despite the fact that there was over six pickets, and despite the fact that we were secondary pickets, he could do bugger all about us. And
as always, we've always got something to get to our speakers. I mean, it's great that they travel all these distances to come down to speak to us here. And there you go, this is what's done. But first of all, Ron, by hook and by crook, we always manage to get an S.O.Davies book. So we've got an S.O.Davies book here, plus a, this is a supplement to it, history, written by They're both written by the author, Robert Griffiths. You know Robert?
Yes, well,
the leader of the Communist Party.
I don't need...
I don't need
a hook and a crook to get Robert you, because he's here every year. And then he's at the back. And I would just say... I looked up and I thought he was looking the other way, but of course, isn't there a
The forest... And the guy looks like you as well.
Yeah. Forest... I mustn't keep looking.
You're better looking
now. Forrest Sims, anyway, is not the general secretary of the Communist Party of Britain.
That's what
and he's a mate of you, isn't he? So we've met him. So there's the Now we've been in the process of trying to build a fantasy football team. But unfortunately, our Trades Council refused to have anybody on the right coming in here to speak. At the moment, that's all we got is Ron, like a left winger, and well, the up and out striker being Bob Crow, of course, and what have you. But anyway, Ron, what we've got here is a nice Liverpool special.
Fantastic.
Liverpool. wait now for me to see this.
Fantastic.
And then we go on to who's
extra.
Is it?
It's Coutinho.
Oh, there you are. So he is right.
Maybe people think I'm Coutinho, or maybe I'm a real footballer. Thank you very much.
And before we finish, I think if Ron is lucky, his friends will take him up to the inn for a pint. Anybody wishing to come up the end, we'll all go up the end and I'll
okay, and I don't know where it is, so we'll be following.
About 10 yards away, just outside.
Okay, we'll do that. Thank you very much.